that that's something that you would like to participate in, that idea excites you, you'd like to learn more about it, let me know and I can get more information and we can talk about setting a group from LCOS down. It would be clearing trees, helping to repair paths or other buildings. There's a lot of work to be done. So again, if you would be interested in joining a work party to work at Luther Ridge or Luther Rock, maybe sometime next summer, talk to me and I can start exploring more details. Let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you. Today comes from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah, beginning with the 31st verse. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors, when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they say to one another or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sins no more. The word of the Lord. We will speak Psalm 46 responsibly. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea.
Though its water rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. The holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord. What desolations God has brought upon the earth.
Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow, shatters the spear, and burns the shield with fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Our second reading today comes from the third chapter of Romans, beginning with the 19th verse. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and that the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. Since we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God, they are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from the works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. I'd like to invite any of our kids up at this time. Hi, everybody. Today is a Sunday that we call Reformation Sunday. Does anyone have any idea what that might mean? Yeah. So that's a good answer, that they find out what Jesus can do. What does it mean if we reform something? What does that sound like? Something is reformed.
Big.
It
sounds like something with it.
Yeah, something gets remade. What do you want to say, Grace?
Like, let's say something gets broken down, we make it again.
Yeah, we fix it. So what happened is that a while ago, like over 500 years ago, there was somebody named Martin Luther. He was looking at the church, and he thought that maybe there were some things that needed to be tweaked a little bit, fixed a little bit. And so it sparked this whole thing that we call the Reformation. And do you know what day he decided to share his biggest ideas?
No.
Yeah. It wasn't a Sunday. It was the day before All Saints Day, which is November 1st, which would mean that he shared his ideas on
Friday.
On the 31st. Yeah, on Halloween, on what we call Halloween. All Hallows Eve, and that was the day that he decided to share his ideas. I want to share with you a little story about Martin Luther's life. I like this because it has pop-ups.
Is it Halloween King?
It is not. When I was a kid, I got that really confused. So this is Martin Luther, who is different than Martin Luther King Jr. Both are very important people in history. Both people did really great things. But this guy was German. And he lived in a time of castles and no electricity. Martin Luther King Jr. was American, and he lived in a time of like buses and cars. So these are two different people. So Martin Luther, he was a young man, and he was going to be a lawyer. But one day he was traveling through a storm that was really bad, and he almost got struck by lightning. And he promised God, if I survive this, I'm going to go be a monk. You ever heard of a monk before? A monk is a person who decides that they're going to dedicate their entire life to their faith in God. And so they usually live in a special place with other monks, and they don't get married, they don't have families, they spend all of their days together in this community that they create. So Martin Luther devoted his life to God, and he began studying the Bible. When he read for himself, what it said about having faith in Jesus. And Martin discovered the very good news that we are saved by faith. Now, before this, not everybody read the Bible. Only those like really religious people, like the priests and the monks, read the Bible. Like, you know how you might read the Bible with your families? That didn't happen back then. They didn't have Bibles in their homes. So Martin Luther didn't like what the church was teaching about faith and good works, and he especially didn't like the teaching that Christians could go to heaven faster by paying money to the church. Can you believe that? So he wrote down 95 ideas and shared them with everybody. So he had a big, long list of 95 things that he wanted to talk about. Not everyone agreed with his ideas, and they were so mad that they brought him before the emperor, and they asked him to take back everything he said. So if you were telling the truth and somebody told you, I don't like what you're saying, you need to say that you don't believe any of that, that would not be a very good thing, would it? Martin Luther's life was in danger. On the way back to his home, the carriage that he was riding in was surrounded by riders. They actually were friends of his who snuck up and hid him away because they were afraid people were gonna hurt him. So they pretended to kidnap him and they hid him away. Martin Luther kept writing his ideas about God, and they printed and spread. So there was this new invention called the printing press, which meant that you could make copies. Have you ever used a copy machine? That goes pretty fast, right? Well, back then they didn't have copy machines. They didn't have electricity or, you know, computers. So they had to take all the individual letters, place all the individual letters for everything, and print it. But that was still really fast. Because do you know how they copied things before the printing press? Any ideas? Yeah. Yeah, so typically you'd have one monk in the front of the room reading out loud, and then a whole room full of monks copying down what he wrote on their paper. So it took a long time to copy anything. Martin Luther inspired a reformation of the church, and many people followed in his footsteps and thought about his ideas. So, if you had a really big idea, how would you share it? Do you think? Yeah.
A nice way.
Going in front of a big gathering of people. How would you share the big news you had? Yeah. If your parents have big news that they want to share with people, how do they share it? Yeah.
They just tell us.
They tell you? Maybe they text a friend? Maybe they FaceTime with somebody? They have some big news to share? We have the internet now, right? We can share lots of stuff super fast. Martin Luther had big ideas that he shared. We have our ideas about faith, and they might not lead to like a reformation of the church, might not lead to a place where we change everything, but it's still really important that we share our faith like Martin Luther did. And we can do that by talking with our friends, talking with the crowd. We can do it through a card, through a text message, through a conversation. There are lots of ways that we can share our faith. Do you guys say a prayer with me?
Yeah.
All right, let's pray. Dear God,
yeah.
Thank you for loving us so much.
Thank you for loving us so much.
And helping us learn.
And helping us so
more about you.
More about you.
Help us grow.
Help us grow.
And change.
And change.
And be your church.
And be your church.
Amen. Amen. All right, you guys can head on back. It's a good or a bad thing that they've run so fast to get back to their families. If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The gospel text appointed for the festival of Reformation is always the same, no matter which of year of the three-year lectionary we're on. I went to Wittenberg University for college, and as you might expect for a place named after the birthplace of the Reformation, we had a Reformation worship service that pulled out all the stops. We sang A Mighty Fortress in German. We used Luther's version of the Holy, 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 and we used a gospel acclamation written by Donald Bussaro, my choir director and the university organist. A setting that he wrote just for us and just for this place that was evidenced because even though he had been using it for years and years and years, we still got photocopied sheets of his handwritten music that was placed in our folder. I love that setting of the acclamation. It echoed the tune of a mighty fortress in bell tones on the organ, and the tune of the acclamation itself is reminiscent of one of the hymns that we're going to sing later today. And because it's the assigned text for the gospel acclamation on Reformation, it reiterated this statement from Jesus. If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. The statement is reiterated as it is surrounded by alleluias, praising God for the gift of truth in our world. Every time I hear or I read this verse, all of that is held within it. Do you have those words or phrases, maybe a biblical passage that every time you hear it, you hear Handel's Messiah in your head, or you hear a line from a favorite hymn? You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. It should be a simple thing, truth, right? Something either is or isn't true, but it's become a loaded concept. As our nation prepares to go to the polls next week, we hear all sorts of people arguing for truth, arguing for their truth, arguing for truth as they see it. Truth in this political discourse has somehow become subjective. This is not the first time. There is a long history of people and communities and nations adjusting and interpreting fact and history to form their own version of truth. Even the Jewish people that Jesus is talking to are doing it in the gospel reading. When Jesus tells them about being set free by knowing the truth, they answer him, "We are descendants of Abraham and we have never been slaves to anyone." I mean, there was that whole Egypt thing, right? Like, that happened. But it seems that for these particular people, at least, that memory, that truth in their history did not serve them in the moment. And so it was left out of their truth. I am full of college reminiscences this week, and I have no idea why, but I'm about to share a story of one of my college professors. Barbara Kaiser was one of the professors that I had in my religion classes, and as she approached the Bible with a scholarly and an academic eye in a class of mostly freshmen who had never thought about the Bible in this way, she told us this. There is a difference between provable scientific fact, lowercase truth, and uppercase truth. Sometimes they will overlap. Sometimes all three will be one and the same, but there will also be times in which some of them oppose each other and jostle for position. She told us that her goal was to teach and present the Bible as best as she could, from a place of facts and the lowercase truth. That uppercase truth, she told us, only we would know how to handle. That was going to be the work of Bible studies, of talks with our pastors or rabbis or religious leaders. That was going to be the work of prayer and devotion. She asked us to keep an open mind, and she promised us a place where we could dwell in our faith, even as we approached our sacred text in a new way. She was one of the best professors I ever had. But she understood that how we see and understand truth has nuance, even if we would like to believe that it doesn't. And she understood that we need to keep the uppercase truth in its proper place if we have any hope of making sense of the rest of it. Dr. Kaiser herself is a person of deep and abiding faith. She knew the power of the truth of the gospel in her life. She knew what it meant. We need the truth. We need things that must be true, even when the rest of the world seems topsy-turvy, or even when the truth is difficult to wrestle with. Because the truth, without it, we are lost or stuck. Without the truth of a diagnosis, can treatment ever really be sought? Or will it just be treating symptoms over and over and over again? Without the truth of how our actions have hurt a friend, can that relationship ever be repaired? Or will the strain and frustration lead to a slow dissolution of what used to be? And without the truth of how certain laws or policies in our communities were written to specifically leave people out or to make their lives more difficult, can justice and equity have a place? Or will we continue to see food deserts and lack of infrastructure in our poorer communities? If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The church at its best is a place where we tell that truth. It is a community of disciples who know the truth and who are set free by it. It is a community of disciples who see the truth of who we are and where we have done wrong and who seek to remedy it. The church at its best is a group of people who are laid bare in the light of truth. Not a place where people hide behind masks of righteousness. Those masks of righteousness is a much more common scenario. Instead of bringing our full, flawed, and sinful selves, it is all too common for us churchgoers to put on a mask of respectability, the mask of piety, the mask of sinlessness, because we've somehow convinced ourselves that that kind of person is who the church is for. Because we've somehow convinced ourselves that that kind of person is everyone else around us, that no one else is in the same boat we are. We fear admitting our mistakes, our shortcomings, our struggles, because we have somehow convinced ourselves that we are the only ones who feel that way. That we are the only ones who are doubting, that we are the only ones who are hurting. There's a saying, I don't know where it first came from, but the saying goes, the holiest hour in a church is on Tuesday evenings in the basement. What group is most likely to meet on a weekday evening in a church basement? AA. The point of this somewhat cheeky phrase is not that Sunday worship is not holy, or that a meeting of alcoholics or addicts is the only place where holiness can happen. But the point is that AA or NA or any group like it requires vulnerability. In order to be a part of that community, it requires acknowledgement, not just to yourself, but to others, your mistakes and your struggles. And the community is not only there to hear you, they're there to receive it. They're not scared off. They're ready and willing to meet you where you are and walk your journey with you. There is a moment to acknowledge the truth of one's own inability to do it alone and to ask for the help of others. When we recognize our truth, when we name where we are hurting, we are also able to recognize our need for each other and our need for God. For God's love, for God's forgiveness, for God's salvation. When the Jews who believe in Jesus say to him, "We have never been slaves to anyone," they are not only mistaken, but they are missing this huge part of God's salvific work in human history, not just in the past, but also in the future. It's missing what God has done and dismissing what God might be up to. Why do we need the truth? Why do we need to be set free, Jesus? They seem to ask. We've been doing just fine and will continue to be just fine. Why do we even need this? Why do we even need you? But truth is what opens our minds and our hearts and our spirits to what God can do. When we recognize it, when we embrace it, when we share it, it makes the church what the church is meant to be, the wounded body of Christ, brought together and sent out for the sake of the world. On Reformation Sunday, we remember that the church is not just something that was created 500 years ago, 2,000 years ago, and stands static. We remember and we look for how, for the ways in which the church is continuing to reform. The body of Christ is not stagnant. It is not stuck in one way of thinking. It is not mired in half-truths and false narratives and spun rhetoric. It is on the move, inspired and energized by the truth. The truth of the incarnation, the truth of the crucifixion and resurrection, the truth of the limitless love God has for us, brought together in our struggles, in our sorrows, in our weaknesses, and in a need for what only God can give us. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing our hymn of the day.
Let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Lord of all, we give thanks for the whole church throughout the world. Open wide the paths towards Christian unity between so that all followers of Christ may join in shared worship and shared mission. God of grace, renewing God, as the dying leaves display their beauty, we are reminded that nature's cycle requires both life and death. Instill in your people a passion for preservation and deepen an appreciation for trees, animals, and waterways threatened by our negligence and harm. God of grace, gracious God, in the spirit of reformation, we pray for all who cry out for relief from oppression. May the hearts of those who occupy seats of power be reformed so that peace and equity became the goal of our life together. God of grace, comforting God, be with all who are sick, suffering, or grieving in our own community and beyond, especially Lee, Tim, Herb, Amanda, Diane, Larry, Ted, their Durkin family, Jean, Tanya, Kathy, Cheryl, Craig, Nancy, Wayne, and Marge, and for all who we keep on our minds and in our hearts. Surround them with the promise of your love, your comfort, and your grace that never ends. God of grace, divine God, continue to challenge this community to be ever reforming in our ministries and outreach efforts. Inspire creative ideas among us and keep the grace-filled word of God at the heart of our ministry. God of grace, Almighty God, in Christ's resurrection, you ensure that through life be wrenched away, death cannot win the day. May the truth of your salvation through the faith sustain our hope for life in you. God of grace,
into your hands, O God, we commend all work we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share that peace with one another. Thank you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus welcomes you to this table. Come, here is your God. You may be seated.
Thank you.
God's grace.
Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace.
Amen.
Remember, we are singing 504, not 505.